Vani Pujarini, Nirvishesha Shunyavani, Paschacha Vishatani. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. From the second chapter, text number 71. It's the second last verse of the Bhagavad of the second chapter. Chapter 2, text 71. Vihaya kamanya sarvam.
Vihaya kamanya sarvam.
Umams charati nishpriha.
Umams charati nishpriha.
Nirmamo nirahankara.
Nirmamo nirahankara.
Stashantim adigachati.
Stashantim adigachati.
Vihaya kamanya sarvan.
Vihaya kamanya sarvan.
Umams charati nishpriha. Vihaya kamanya sarvan.
Vihaya kamanya sarvan.
Umams charati nishpriha.
Umams charati nishpriha.
Nirmamo nirahankara.
Nirmamo nirahankara.
Sashantim adigachati.
Without false ego.
Sa.
Sa.
Hi.
Hi.
Shanti.
Shanti.
Perfect peace.
Perfect peace.
Adigacchati.
Adigacchati.
Attains.
Attains.
Translation. A person who has given up all desires for sense gratification, who lives free from desires, and who has given up all sense of proprietorship and is devoid of false ego, he alone can attain real peace. Please repeat. A person,
who has given up
all desires for sense gratification,
all desires for sense gratification,
who lives free from desires,
who lives free from desires,
who has given up,
all sense of proprietorship, all sense of proprietorship,
and is devoid of false ego,
and is devoid of false ego,
he alone,
can attain real peace.
Purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. To become desireless means not to desire anything for sense gratification. In other words, desire for becoming Krishna conscious is actually desirelessness. To understand one's actual position as the eternal servitor of Krishna, without falsely claiming this material body to be oneself, and without falsely claiming proprietorship over anything in the world, is the perfect stage of Krishna consciousness. One who is situated in this perfect stage knows that because Krishna is the proprietor of everything, everything must be used for the satisfaction of Krishna. Arjuna did not want to fight for his own sense satisfaction, but when he became fully Krishna conscious, he fought because Krishna wanted him to fight. For himself, there was no desire to fight, but for Krishna, the same Arjuna fought to his best ability. Real desirelessness is desire for the satisfaction of Krishna, not an artificial attempt to abolish desires. The living entity cannot be desireless or senseless, but he does have to change the quality of the desires. A materially desireless person certainly knows that everything belongs to Krishna, Isavashyam idam sarvam, and therefore he does not falsely claim proprietorship over anything. This transcendental knowledge is based on self-realization, namely, knowing perfectly well that every living entity is an eternal part and parcel of Krishna in spiritual identity, and that the eternal position of the living entity is therefore never on the level of Krishna or greater than him. This understanding of Krishna consciousness is the basic principle of real peace. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Chalakaya Chatsur Militamena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manovistam Tapitam yena bhutale svayam rupa tatamayam dadati svapadantikam vandeham shri guru shri yata padakamalam shri gurun vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sakratatam Sahadana Pratinatam Vitaktam Sajivam Sattvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakha Dikamscha Hey Krishna Karna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostate Tapta Kanchana Gorange Radhe Vrindavan Vishavanu Sukhe Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpata Rubhyasya Kripa Sindhu Vaye Vacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namah Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vinda Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna Krishna, Krishna, Hare 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 Rama, Hare Rama Rama, Rama, Hare Hare
Jai Jagannath Baladev Subhadra Jai Ki Jai So very happy to see so many of you here this evening. We want to just simply share this message of the Bhagavad Gita with all of you. Krishna is describing to us how we can get peace, right? This is, of course, going to come again in the fifth chapter, but the final verse of the fifth chapter, the peace formula is there. So this verse is similar to that verse in the fifth chapter. Krishna is summarizing here, at the end of the second chapter, the contents of the Gita summarized. He's going over his main teachings, what he's going to explain in the course of 18 chapters of Bhagavad Gita. Some karma yoga, some jnana yoga, and a little portion of bhakti yoga has also been introduced in the second chapter. But the point about being peaceful is very important for all of us. Of course, people often have sentimental ideas about what it means to be peaceful. They think, oh, peaceful means put down your weapons, right? Don't fight, don't kill each other, no war. At the time of when there's some war and agitation going on, then the people want peace, right? I remember as a student, when I was a student, that's a very long time ago, but we had a thing called ban the bomb, right? Because the people, America was having their bombs and Russia had their bombs and the threat that there's going to be some big war between these two great nations. So we would campaign, ban the bomb. It's still going on a little bit, you know. Trump had a big meeting in Singapore some time back with North Korea, encouraging North Korea not to build nuclear weapons. So they're thinking this will be peace. Prabhupada also spoke about United Nations, how the United Nations, they make a very colorful presentation, the flags of all the different nations. And even when Prabhupada was there in the 60s in New York, they had a prayer for peace outside the United Nations. And the devotees also went and chanted. So Prabhupada said, just to have a colorful presentation of flags didn't bring about peace in the world. It's not enough. Here in the Bhagavad Gita, we're getting a very exact message about what we actually need to do, not only to have peace in the world between nations and between societies, but how the individual can be peaceful, how we as an individual can be at peace. And that is a real challenge. Many of you have a lot of trouble trying to keep calm, trying to be peaceful, a lot of stress. Drive in the traffic is stressing. You work, there's stress, competition with others. And nowadays it's a lot of stress just to try to keep a job. What to speak of promotion to get a higher position. You're lucky if you can just keep a job, because the economy all over the world is so bad that many people, more and more people, are facing unemployment. So that the cause of anxiety means a lack of peace. Can it be peaceful? How to be peaceful? When we have children growing up every day, they watch your children. You worry about the children, they have exams, or they may have some problem with people at the school, maybe even problems with teachers and so on. And so it influences our mental condition. We're not able to be peaceful. Sometimes the neighbors also disturb our peace. Of course, our neighbors may complain about us, that we disturb their peace, right? So trying to be peaceful is a great challenge in this modern society. But Krishna is giving us some pointers which will help us to actually come to the platform where we can find peace. And he mentions, first of all, giving up that sense of proprietorship, because we do think that this is mine, this belongs to me. Of course, we all have that feeling of proprietorship. And to an extent also, it's not wrong. But we have to understand that it's actually Krishna's property, but Krishna is giving it to us to take care of. A devotee should not be neglectful. Just like we're given some, you have children, we should take care of them. We have to look after them. We have a responsibility to them. And you have elderly parents also. There's some responsibility there to take care of them. So we have to think of our different duties which are there. Krishna doesn't encourage us to give up our duty. In fact, the Bhagavad Gita, a lot of it is Krishna pleading with Arjuna that you have to do your duty. But we have to do our duty in the right consciousness, in the consciousness that we're doing it for Krishna. The problem comes that we're thinking, I'm doing this for myself. We want to enjoy. We're thinking the results are for me. So, of course, this is elaborately discussed in the first six chapters of the Bhagavad Gita, particularly the third chapter, where Krishna speaks about karma yoga. Because Arjuna was concerned about the sinful reactions which would come on him. And Krishna taught Arjuna, if you do karma yoga, then no reactions. You don't have to worry about the reactions. But karma yoga means performing our duty in a detached manner.
Right. Prabhupada often quotes the verse about describing karma yoga, a verse which is well known, karmani eva dikaraste mapaleshu kadachana. People are fond of this first part, karmani eva dikaraste. You have a right to do your duty. I remember on one occasion I was traveling in India doing Sankirtan, going to visit different businessmen and speaking to them, asking them to enroll as life members of our Krishna consciousness movement. So you get these kind of people, they say, yes, I know Bhagavad Gita. Krishna says, karmani eva dikaraste, I have a right to do my duty, right? But they never quote the next part, mapaleshu kadachana, that the fruit is not for you. The fruit belongs to Krishna. So that's something people only see what they want to see in the Bhagavad Gita. Krishna is saying, I have a right to work, I have a right to do my business, I have a right to get money and make money. But Krishna says, the fruit does not belong to you. But it's given to us, we have to use it properly, right? Use it properly. Use it in the service of Krishna. That is proper. We take what we need for our own self. Don't take more. Prabhupada in the purport was quoting from the Upanishad. Ishyavashyam idam sarvam yat kincha jagatyam jagat. Tena chaktena bunjada. Magridaha Kashaswitana. Everything that is animate or inanimate that is within the universe is controlled and owned by the Lord. One should accept, therefore, only those things which are necessary for himself, and one should not accept more, knowing well to whom they belong. We should understand it belongs to Krishna. We take what we need. We don't take more. And whatever extra is there, of course, we want to utilize that in the service of Krishna. So this is particularly important in the case of wealthy people. Generally, most people who are working people. Working people, you don't make a lot of money. You don't get a lot of money when you work in a job. But if you're a successful businessman, then we hope, you can make more money. And then, with more money, you have the opportunity to utilize it in the service of Krishna. That is Krishna consciousness. Recognizing that everything belongs to Krishna and using it in his service. Of course, easy to say, difficult to do. But there are some very wonderful persons who do, who actually live according to that principle. They utilize their energies nicely in the service of Krishna. Just like we see this nice structure out here, which was contributed by our very nice devotee there. You see? And of course, Mayapur Temple also, the major portion of Mayapur Temple, funded by some Alfred Ford and Ambarish Prabhu, giving a lot of money to help to construct the temple. So that is proper use of wealth. You use it for Krishna. Use this life in the service of Krishna. That is also very good. I was just in Butterworth, Sepranjaya, and we had the passing away just a few days ago. One of the devotees passed away, left the body. But it was very glorious. that he had dedicated himself for the service of Krishna for more than a year before succumbing to illness and leaving the world. Now, we all know we're going to leave the world, but how many of us dedicate our life, you know, even 1 year for the service of Krishna? So it was a very glorious departure to see a young man who was also well educated. When he was in the hospital, one of the doctors had asked him, "What's your education?" And he told them, "Well, I got 9 A's when I was at school." And the doctor was shocked. Wow. 9 A's, you know. Someone with 9 A's, usually they get scholarships to go to Europe or something. But he became a full-time devotee. Gave his life for the service of Krishna. And he could leave the world in Krishna consciousness, because one of our devotees also took the trouble to be with him constantly, reminding him about Krishna and preparing prasadam and everything for him. So this, of course, this is it. This is devotee care. This is real caring. A very wonderful lady from Ipoh, she was at the hospital all day, every day, taking care of him and giving him a lot of Krishna conscious association. And he was very happy to get that association also. So this is a wonderful example for us, how a young person, he was 21, came to Krishna consciousness when he was like 18 or 19 and spend a short time in Krishna consciousness and leave the world in Krishna consciousness. That is very wonderful, very rare. So we were appreciating the devotee's good fortune, and we can see his sacrifice. Sacrifice means recognizing this body doesn't belong to me. This body belongs to Krishna. Rishikesh, right? Rishikesha Rishikena Sevanam Bhakti Ruchate. Krishna is the proprietor of the senses. So this body actually belongs to Krishna. We are thinking, it's my body. And worse than that, we're thinking, I am the body. You know, that's the lower stage. At the bottom, we think, I am the body. And a little higher, we think, well, it's my body. But a devotee doesn't think it's my body. We think this body belongs to Krishna. It's given to me by the grace of Krishna. And I have to use it in the service of Krishna. So giving up all sense of proprietorship is a very deep level of commitment to Krishna consciousness. Because we are so attached to the material things. Our home, our car, our family, we're thinking all mine. We have to remember that it's all Krishna's, and we have to use it in the service of Krishna. Then Krishna also mentions giving up false ego. The false ego, ahankar, right? That false ego which binds us into the material world. Again, this ahankar, we're thinking, I am the doer. I have done this. I have built this. I have made this. But a devotee has pure ego. We cannot, just as desires cannot, we cannot come without desire, similarly we cannot give up ego, but we can purify ego. The false ego is thinking, I am the doer, I am the enjoyer, but the true ego is to think I am the servant, Krishna is the doer, and I am simply the instrument in the service of Krishna. Of course, in the 11th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna will remind Arjuna about that, telling him, Nimitta Matra Bhava Satya Savya Satya. Just become an instrument in my service. So that is pure ego. So trying to become free of desires, Prabhupada explains to us that for a devotee, it means to desire simply for the service of Krishna. We cannot stop desire, but we can purify the desire. To be without desire is an artificial condition. We all have desires, right? We all have some kind of desires. Jai Jagannath Mahadev Subhadra Ki Jai. The nature of the mind is to desire. So, if we want to purify the desires, we have to learn how to control the mind. And in Krishna consciousness, the process of controlling the mind is to fix it on Krishna, to bring the mind to thoughts of Krishna. Therefore, we give so much importance to hearing and chanting. It's very important for us to hear regularly, because we are conditioned souls. We do have a lot of material desires, and we have a lot of false ego, and we need to purify it. And the purification can be done very effectively by hearing and chanting. So these programs, that's like Prabhupada wanted, these centers everywhere, are very important. They're meant for us to come together to hear and chant. And in this way, help us to conquer over our conditioned nature. It's a great struggle, it's a great battle. Just like Arjuna, he's supposed to fight the battle. Arjuna doesn't want to do it, but Krishna wants him to do it. Therefore, he's going to do it. In the same way, we should think, Krishna wants me to wake up early in the morning, to chant my rounds. Krishna wants me to come regularly to the temple and to hear the classes, to take part in the programs. Krishna wants me to do some service. It's our duty. Our conditioned nature is very powerful. Oh, we make excuses. I'm so busy. You don't know what it's like. We have so many reasons why we can't do things. And I'm sure they're good reasons, but we have to overcome all of the obstacles, right? We know there are going to be obstacles. And that's why we worship Lord Nrsingadev. Lord Nrsingadev destroys all the obstacles on the path of devotion. Of course, Hindu people think we have to worship Ganesh to destroy the obstacles. But Lord Ganesh, he gets the power from Lord Nrsingadev. So we take the shelter of the Lord Nrsingadev, and he can destroy all the obstacles which we're facing. Well, we know there will always be problems in material life. We cannot think no problems, but the problems themselves are pleasing to a devotee, because the problems mean that we're getting purification from it. The problems mean that we're using up all that bad karma which we have. We have a lot of bad karma.
not only from this life, from previous lives also. We have a lot of reactions coming to us. Remember, in Bhagavad and Nectar of Devotion is described the different stages of reactions from past activity. Some are manifest, some are unmanifest, and some are lying as seed, and some are just about fructifying. Different stages of sinful reactions, all coming upon us. And the only way we can overcome these things is by devotional service, by engaging wholeheartedly in devotional service. And devotional service is very much more concentrated here in the temple room. This is the best place to do our chanting, to do our hearing, to do our service, to be here in this particular room, in the association of the deities. The Lord has come in the form of the deity. Srila Prabhupada is here. We have so much opportunity for purification. It's not so easy to think of Maya when you're here in this place. You go away, you go home, you know, it's very, very difficult for us to control the mind. You sit down, you have televisions, you have mobile phones, you have computers, you have so many, you have family members, husbands and wives, and all of these things are there, all just to distract us from our devotional service. Very hard for us to control the mind. Therefore, very important for us to make great efforts to fix the mind on Krishna. And the healthy way is to come to the temple, to take advantage of this wonderful facility which is here. You come here and take part in the program, chanting, associating with devotees. So many wonderful festivals are held here. The Kuala Lumpur Janmashtami is very much appreciated in many other parts of the world. People see the pictures on Facebook, the very, very exquisitely beautiful flower decorations which have been done here for the festivals. Very attractive. Everything is done very nicely. So it's so important for us to also be a part of these activities. We have to come and learn how to do all of these nice things. Some of our devotees even come from Hong Kong to take part in the Janmashtami here. This is so wonderful. So very special festivals. So often when we're close to something, we don't appreciate it. You know, we say familiarity breeds contempt. But we should actually understand how fortunate we are to have this very nice opportunity, the nice association. It's very, very rare to get such opportunities. Krishna consciousness is there for everyone, but not everybody wants it. That's the problem. We think, well, I still have time. Maybe next life I'll become more serious. One devotee, he was writing a book, and my godbrother, and you know, he's a very senior devotee. He's been a devotee, he joined the movement very, very early on. And so he wrote it into the book, "I'm sure I can do better next life, Prabhupada." "I'm sure next life I can do better." Well, we shouldn't think like that, right? We should think, make this life a commitment. I'm going to do it in this life. I'm going to become Krishna conscious in this life. Next life, we don't know. You don't know what's going to happen. The one devotee who left a few days ago, he was very fortunate. We may not be so fortunate. We have to be very conscious and very careful to make the best of this human life. That we don't want to come back again. We don't want to give trouble to the spiritual teacher, that they have to come and find us and try to take us out of this material world. We should be very committed to really give everything for the service of Krishna, make a success of this life. And so many other things can wait. We have these desires, but our real desire should be to surrender to Krishna, to be committed to Krishna's service. That is wanted. Just like Arjuna. Arjuna is really committed to Krishna. He's not just Krishna's friend, but he's a sold-out devotee. And he's ready to do the most difficult things because Krishna wants him to do it. You know, Krishna is not asking any of us to go on the battlefield and kill our teacher or our grandfather. But he's asking Arjuna to do it. So what we're, you know, what are we asked to do? Oh, maybe, can you join the Harinam Sankirtan party? Oh, no. Ask people, go out on Sankirtan. Would you like to go out on Sankirtan? Would you like to go and distribute books? Oh, Prabhu. You know, we're not so willing to take up these kind of services. So how could we ever do what Arjuna is doing? So we have to try to become a little more committed, make greater efforts to give this life for the service of Krishna. Because this is Kali Yuga, and it's only 500 years since Lord Chaitanya has been here. It's a very golden age, a special time. Simply by chanting, we can get all perfection. So at least we must commit ourselves fully to that. We've got to do this chanting every day. Try to do this chanting and try to do 16 rounds or more in a day. That's very helpful to getting the best out of this life and to pleasing Krishna. Krishna wants us to surrender, and that surrender comes with the chanting of the holy name. Gradually we get our mind under control, we start to think more about Krishna. And as we chant more, we will get more inspiration how we can actually be Krishna conscious in every situation. Troubles are going to be there. We know problems come. But a devotee will simply pass over all the problems without any great difficulty. We give the example, just like these big liners, big ships, they go across the ocean and they have huge storms, big waves. If you see some of these ships, they have so many containers, you know, everything's in containers these days, and they load these ships with big containers. I went to Russia, and in Russia there's one temple, it's very near to the port in Vladivostok, and they have a big port there, and I saw the ships, they load all these big containers on, so many big high mountain of containers on the ship, and then the ship goes out to sea, crosses the ocean, and you know, big waves, and the ship goes up and down. Like, you know, if you're on the ship, definitely you'd be thinking, I think it'd be safer to get off. But if you get off the ship, then you have no hope. You have to stay on the ship. And the same is true in Krishna consciousness, that sometimes the difficulties come, they do come, but we don't get off the ship. We have to hold on to our sadhana. That is what will save us
from all the difficulties which come. If we don't have a good sadhana, then we will feel greatly troubled and perplexed by all the problems of material life. But if we have a very strong sadhana every day to do our chanting and worship Krishna, then the difficulties won't be, they'll be insignificant. They won't trouble a devotee. The troubles are only there for the non-devotees. They feel the difficulty. A devotee doesn't feel trouble. A devotee is grateful for the difficulties which come. Krishna is helping me to remember him more. And Krishna is helping me to get rid of all this karma, making it easier for us so that we can go back to Godhead. Just like in Srimad Bhagavatam, you have the example of Vritasura. Chitraketu was a great devotee and he was cursed to become a big demon. Vrita, one who is spread everywhere. Vritasura had this huge body and he was fighting Indra. And Indra cut off one arm and then he cut off another arm and then Vritasura, I mean, Vritasura swallowed him or something. He swallowed Indra. He opened his mouth wide and swallowed Indra. And then Indra took his weapon and he cut off, opened the insides of the stomach of Vritasura and came out. So Vritasura, he's a great devotee, but he was put into the body of a demon. Why? So he could get rid of all of his karma and he could go back to Godhead. It made it easier for him to finish off all of his remaining karma and go back to God. So when we get difficulties, we should think like that. That this is good. Krishna is reducing my reactions, my sinful reactions. He's making it easier for me to get out of this world, to go back to God. So this is a nice way to look at the problems and the difficulties which come on us. Everywhere I go, people come, they tell me their problems. So some people have a big list of problems. Somebody just sent me an email, 16 different things. And that was all in relation to the temple. Not this temple, another temple, somewhere in Burma. Burma. So a long list, my goodness. Anyway, that's some of the problems which we face in life. We have to go on, be Krishna conscious. We have to remember Krishna. It's easy to, oh, I don't have this, we have that wrong, this is not right, and they're doing like that. Okay. But don't they do it? When somebody would come to Prabhupada, just to give a little example, somebody would come to Prabhupada and complain about someone. And Prabhupada would hear all the complaints, then he would say, does he do anything good? And then, he does good kirtan. And so then, why don't you say that? Why you only have to say the faults? Why only say the faults? Why can't you say the good thing? That they do a nice kirtan? That's how it should be, right? See the good. Tomorrow Krishna Goswami wrote, when he was a new devotee, he wrote to Prabhupada, glorifying the devotees. And Prabhupada wrote back, he was so pleased. He said, very nice. You're glorifying the devotees. You're seeing the good in the devotees. But when people would write to Prabhupada complaining about devotees, Prabhupada would say, oh, again, this neophyte tendency. Simply fault-finding. Simply see the faults. Not very good. So we want to try to be positive, to see the good things, go on, become fully Krishna conscious. Any questions?
Anybody? Ramananda?
Hari Bol.
Nice to see you. I was saying Ananda Dola should move in the temple. I didn't think this temple. I was hoping you were going to move in the temple up north. You came here. Any question? Anyone? Comment? Sometimes people have questions, they wait till after the class and they come up and they all line up and they're, can I ask you a question? They don't want to ask in front of everybody else. In some places what we do, we have to give out pieces of paper and we get them to write down a question and then they pass the paper forward and read out. They don't like to speak out the question. Maybe we have to do like that here, trying to solicit more response here from the audience. Even when Bhakti Tirtha Swami came here, remember that? Bhakti Tirtha Swami came here and he gave his seminar. His seminar was very much depending on audience participation and he found it quite difficult. He said the Malaysian people are very reserved. You know, you go to Russia, Russian people, very, there are so many questions, you know, endless questions, you know. It's like that.
Staying far away from the temple, so whether they can do some service not in the temple but in the house, like tying garlands, taking care of deities, is that will consider as a service or is just?
Oh, definitely, yeah. Whatever they do for Krishna, that's service. Just like we had that one lady in Penang, she was making ghee wicks, folding cotton wool into little ghee wicks, and we would dip them in oil. So she did that for a long time. She made thousands and thousands of those cotton wicks. She would sit and do it. Very nice. That is service. I get people, when I go to, we have one lady here in Malaysia also, but in China also, I get, if they sew, if they say they have a sewing machine, they do sewing, I tell them, make me bead bags. Make some bead bags. And so they make bead bags, and I get so many bead bags. I have a big collection of bead bags in Bangkok. Can give them out to devotees. Keep people engaged in Krishna service. Somebody makes bead bags, somebody makes deity out, deity dresses. And some people make jewelry. Some people get beads and just string the beads and make little necklaces for the deities. Some people, little bracelets for the deities, put some beads on, a piece of elastic. That's all nice service for Krishna, wonderful service. So doing this, yeah, you can do it at home. You don't have to be here in the temple. You can sit at home and do these things. Very nice. Some people, of course, make sweets at home and bring them to offer to the deity. Making sweets and different savories and bring to offer to the deity, can distribute.
Regarding that question, Maharaj said we can do the service at home, do this, but a proper encouragement, well, like if we are doing one center, must be there, have to attend once a week to the temple to take a congregation, associations, and
yeah, generally, once a week, you need to come to be with the devotees. But you need to have some time with the devotees. Because you're at home, it's a little different. You won't have much kirtan. You know, difficult to have kirtan and difficult to have philosophical discussions or classes and so on when you're at home. So association with devotees is very important.
And that's why I was speaking tonight about coming here to the center, being in the temple, to join in the kirtan, taking part in the kirtan, and seeing the beautiful deities. You know, I don't think anybody at home will worship deities on the same level we do here in the temple room. It's so high standard, you know, beautiful dresses, changed every day, like that. So it's important for us to come here and feel the spiritual atmosphere. I remember as a new devotee coming to the temple, you know, just coming in the temple room, I could feel the energy. It's so different. It's such a, so different out there and in here. You know, I was always so happy to get in the temple, come out from the busy street, the noisy street, and then you come off the street and come into the temple. Oh, you know, it's just totally different, such a transformation of energy. You can feel the spiritual energy in the temple room because the walls, all the atoms here are full with the chanting of the holy name and the worship of Krishna. So it's very powerful in spiritual energy. We need to come to the temple at least once a week. We need to come and take part in some kind of program and be with devotees, share with them. Very important. You know, once a week is hardly, it's not really enough. That's the thing. And you should feel like that. If you don't feel like that, then something is wrong. If you're thinking, oh, once a week is enough, then it's not very good. It means your consciousness is not very good. We're not much appreciating. We should feel that this is the real. We may not be able to come more than once a week due to different restrictions, but we should lament. We should feel bad about it, that I wish I could come more. I wish I could be more in the temple. I wish I could, many people also say, I wish I could be a full-time devotee. They want to be full-time. They want to experience the Krishna consciousness every day, all day. Okay, thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki.
Now staying at the year, Madam.